Now jazz singer George Melly takes us on a personal grand tour around the one-time home of the Surrealists, Paris.
I had become fascinated by Surrealism during the war when I was about 16 or so. I'd happened upon a book, an English book called Surrealism, edited by Herbert Reed. But Edouard, my Belgian friend, was also my boss, fascinated me by telling me tales of the Surrealists and his friendship with them and the sort of pranks they got up to, the deliberate scandals they created. So I used to pester Edouard to talk to me about his early days in Paris, about his first visit as a young man, where he happened that very evening to bump into Man Ray, in fact the photographer, who took him immediately for supper with Brancusi, the great sculptor. And he so excited me that I decided that at the first opportunity I must visit Paris. So when I had my first holiday, I persuaded my mother to give me £40, which was then quite enough to travel to Paris. And I bought a ticket at Victoria Station and got on the train and eventually got off in Paris.
Grand Tour, Paris, with George Melly.
I headed straight for Montmartre because I knew that's where the Surrealists mostly met, and booked myself into a very small hotel, very grimy hotel, and I suspect used for other purposes during the day, because whenever I went out in the morning, the proprietor of the hotel would always ask when I would expect to be back. And indeed, I found one evening a long blonde hair on my pillow. My hair is dark, and there was always a smell of cheap scent in this damp little room. I'd also taken to seeing French films, and I saw that marvellous film Enfant du Paradis, but which gave one this feeling of a city of total mystery and poetry and above all love. So I arrived, aged I suppose 21 and a half, with all these dreams. And what struck me that very first evening was that Paris didn't betray the dreams. And I also thought, in pursuit of the sort of image I had of Paris, that I'd better go to bed with a French whore. I'd never been to bed with a whore before. In fact, I'd been to bed with remarkably few women, really. But I picked up, in the same bar, a rather homely-looking whore, you know, but she suggested to me that we also took with us her sister. And we went to a hotel very similar to the one I was staying in, actually. It'd been too much if it'd been the same one. And while I was with her, pleasuring myself with the more beautiful whore, I wondered why she was holding my head so hard, and I broke loose and glanced and saw that the other one, who had suggested that she came with us, was actually removing my wallet, which had all my money in it, from my coat. I said, "What are you doing?" She said, "Well, I'm looking for your photo, chérie," which I said, "Oh, yes." Well, I took the wallet from her. So then I started off, plus a packet of gold was, plus a great deal of cheap wine, feeling I already belonged to that city, which, of course, was an absurd notion.
Meanwhile, you can be sure of meeting me in Paris, of not spending more than 3 days without seeing me pass, towards the end of the afternoon, along the Boulevard Bonne Nouvelle between the Matin printing office and the Boulevard de Strasbourg. I don't know why it should be precisely here that my feet take me, here that I almost invariably go without specific purpose, without anything to induce me but this obscure clue, namely that it will happen here.
Picasso from Spain, Miro also, writers like Hemingway, Scott Fitzgerald, all these people moved in on Paris. There were the impresarios of Paris, people like Apollinaire, and the explosions like Cubism and everything going on. Enormous intelligence bubbling and fizzling. I mean, there is that champagne-like quality of the intelligence in Paris during certain eras. The 20s must have been amazing there, and it was then, of course, Surrealism emerged from the ashes of Dada and brought again yet another perception of the city. And the Surrealists sought out those places which seemed to them magic. And quite recently, I deliberately went to Paris with a friend, and we set off to visit them. And we drove out, in particular, to a park famous for its crime. The park is called the Buttes Chaumont, and it is the most artificial park I've ever been in. It has a lake, and from the lake rises an enormous artificial island of immense height with a belvedere on the top of it. There are bridges swung between the edges of the lake and this island, one of which is very, very high up, and from which, in the 19th century, many people committed suicide simply because they were tempted by the abyss, according to Aragon, who wrote a marvellous description of this place.
The path to the Belvedere is barred at night by a removable grille, which can easily be circumvented along the grass verges. Then the path forks. In one direction, the scene becomes picturesque in the Swiss manner, a little bridge and lots of greenery. But the other view is awe-inspiring, with its cliff dropping straight down to the lake and the mountain's jagged stratifications, handmade but by the hand of a giant. And like a man clasping his own human hands, the two footpaths meet again at a little Greco-Romantic temple whose Louis XVI pillars support a dome in the style of the Chapel of Atonement. We descend by marble paving stones, broad and flat and irregularly cut, that bring to memory my childhood rituals of jumping down staircases, along streets, on alternate slabs. You are only allowed to walk along the marble streaks and countless metaphysical games. To the right, a charming statue representing a prostrate man grappling an eagle. What moral does this group point, and why do you take sides? Who is right? Who will win? And here, right in front of you, is the great suspension bridge, forbidden to make it sway from side to side. I shall certainly make a point of doing just that.
One wanders about, ever delighted. If you lose your way, which is an irritation anywhere else, it's a delight in Paris. You suddenly come upon something extraordinary, you know, a taxidermist full of extraordinary animals dressed up in human clothes or whatever it may be. On every corner, or turning every corner, especially if one's lost, there is a sense of a very intense life going on, irrespective of the visitors, irrespective of the tourists. It still somehow holds together. Now, alas, something has left Paris. It left at the end of the war, in my view, or very shortly after. It certainly had gone by the 60s. Which that it no longer has the confidence of its living culture, and in an extraordinary way. Surrealism and existentialism both fizzled out, the former with the death of André Breton. You know, there are small groups of people claiming still to be surrealists and fighting amongst each other, but that's gone. Existentialism is a philosophy nobody seems to bother with anymore. Where are the painters? Where is the School of Paris? It doesn't exist. But now, I mean, ask me a French writer, I can't mention one, or French poet, not one, French painter, not one. But in the end, there is a dearth and a death, creatively. And yet, somehow, for me, it hasn't yet affected the city. One tends not to notice the McDonald's, if one can. But there are still plenty of small, discreet, sometimes rather bad restaurants hidden away, where one sits next to a solemn businessman with his napkin tucked in and eats, if necessary, pommes frites or with a steak or an omelette. But one feels one is in Paris. One feels it's not so different. The paper napkins are the same. The carafe of wine is the same. Filthy, usually, but there we are. And it is possible to feel in touch with the past as well as the present, which is harder and harder to do in London, in my view. It lacks perhaps the electricity of New York, but it hasn't yet, although I fear for it, especially with the opening of Disneyland on the outskirts. It hasn't yet totally succumbed to an alien culture. The bidets, cracked or not, are still in the hotel bedrooms.
J'irai jusqu'au bout du monde, je me ferai teindre en blonde si tu me demandais. J'irai décrocher la lune, j'irai voler la fortune si tu me le demandais.
I was amazed on my first visit to notice that suddenly a young couple would spontaneously kiss in the street. There is indeed a famous photograph, I forget who by, of a couple in the midst of an indifferent crowd, kissing passionately, not just a brush on the cheek. But it doesn't look in any way provocative in Paris. It's acceptable, somehow, that lovers should kiss.
Le ciel bleu sur nous peut s'effondrer et la terre devient s'écrouler.
Whenever I've had lovers, I've always been to Paris with them, because somehow it gave a different emphasis, a different angle on what in London might appear rushed or desultory or fading. I was always revived by the City of Lights. It's dedicated to love.
There is one thing about the great capitals of Europe that has so far escaped the geographers, namely that some of them are masculine and others feminine. London, Berlin, and Moscow are masculine cities. Paris is pronouncedly feminine. Not that the human feminine element is in the majority or in any sense dominant in the French capital. It is the atmosphere of Paris as a whole that is feminine, something soft and alluring about it. Indefinable something that gives Paris its famous animated, sparkling, vibrating air, and one might almost say saturates the very pavements with an erotic fluid.
I'm not at all original in saying that Paris is a feminine city. People have said it almost since the first stone was laid, I suppose. And in this, it's a great contrast to most cities, which are, I feel, masculine. London is an immensely masculine city. One would never conceive of addressing London as a woman. But Paris has this extraordinary feminine quality, which the Surrealists above all recognized, so that they wrote love letters to Paris, some of them angry and jealous, but all of them very involved with the feminine aspect of the town. In fact, André Breton decided that a particular plus on an island in the middle of the Seine, which in itself resembles a woman, in that her legs and arms seem to be stretched out towards the shores of the city as a whole. This place is in the form of a triangle, Place Dauphine, I think, with trees at one end. And Breton said, this veritably is the sex of Paris, you know, the sexual organ of Paris. Which I went there quite recently, funnily enough, with a friend, and we sat there and said, oh, well, here we are, sitting right on the pudenda of Paris. And suddenly I burst into hysterics because I noticed that on one side of it was a cafe called the Cafe Fanny. I thought, that's certainly part of the certainty of hazard. There is something that is very perverse and affectionate and warm and treacherous and everything else that makes one convinced that one is courting this complicated, seductive, slightly mad woman that is Paris. And of course, as the Surrealists indeed pointed out, The only thing that threatens this feminine myth are certain of the monuments, in particular the Eiffel Tower, for heaven's sake, which couldn't be more phallic if it tried very hard. But what they did about these things was to get rid of them in one way or another. The Eiffel Tower was to be... the bottom was to be demolished, leaving the top floating in the air, if that were possible.
As for the law courts, Breton suggested raising them to the ground and tracing a magnificent graffito on the site to be seen from the air. Paul Éluard wanted to replace them with a bathing pool. Benjamin Perret agreed, but proposed that it should admit only beautiful nude women. Breton wanted to change the opera, symbol of official culture, into a foundation of perfumes and rebuild the staircase with the bones of prehistoric animals. Tristan Tzara preferred human skeletons, replacing the exterior baroque decoration, and to rehouse inside that section of the zoo devoted to monkeys and kangaroos. Religion, symbolized by Notre Dame, got off less lightly. Breton wanted its towers replaced by an immense oil and vinegar court. The building would be used as a school for the sexual education of virgins.
I think, in a way, Paris is much more a visual city and a city of smells, although those two are fading. I mean, the unbelievable smell of the metro system, a mixture of electricity, Gauloise and garlic, is fading as the old trains are replaced by modern ones. The almost exciting smell of bad drains, somehow. The smell of very strong perfume that women tend to wear as they pass you. And the smell of the bars, you know, the smell of Pernod held up to the nose, that curious smell of anisette. One's very much aware of the smells of Paris and of the sights. This curious texture of the walls, old walls, which in London or New York would simply look shabby, somehow compose themselves in such a way as they appear very beautiful. And the posters also, the way they're peeled off here and there, you know, and one sees, especially in the rain, the ghost of a previous image coming through. But the sounds, well, there are the obvious sounds, now entirely for the benefit of tourists, see. Creaking, scratchy creaking of the accordion, which one feels is not played seriously anymore. It's played simply to make people feel they're in a French film, you know, that they may have seen. I suppose, in fact, the characteristic sound of Paris is of the motor horn, as that's very much still present. It's a curiously angry and irritated sound. It doesn't indicate I'm coming, I'm just warning you. It's a sound of constant rage, as if somehow the motor car and the Parisian were enemies rather than in allegiance. And to listen to it, that high-pitched shrieking and honking and imprecations that frequently follow them, and shouting and salon and all this, is I suppose the sound I associate with Paris. There is not the watery sounds of Venice, not even the sound of London, which is indefinable, a sort of hum. You don't get that hum in Paris. You just get the crossness of the suicidal creatures known as motorists.
Eiffel Tower itself, which you must ascend at least once in your life, partly in order to enjoy the view, partly in order to satisfy your own conscience. But if you do go up the Eiffel Tower, keep it a dead secret, and do not mention it to anyone, as such an undertaking is regarded as ridiculous and provincial.
I find the Eiffel Tower irresistible. There is something so ridiculous about it. Its height, for a start, its uselessness. The terrible restaurants you can get to by going up in a lift, including one right near the top. I was once invited to go and act the part of a British TV producer in a film by the Yugoslavian director, Makovejev. And I went over to Paris for the week end. and spent a whole weekend freezing up the Eiffel Tower. I had to suddenly discover that a couple of lovers had frozen in the position of love, unable to escape from the cold, and they were hurried off under a canopy by nuns, and such like things happen. And so, for me, I have a great affection for it, including for the way that the cafes are always open, and I was constantly fed brandy by the director in order to keep my teeth from chattering during this small scene. So I saw it, as it were, having another function, the background to a film, and I retain an affection for it. The big cafes, the big literary cafes, are an awful fake now. I mean, the Café de Flore and the Café de Margot were famous because Sartre and Camus and all the existentialists who were famous just after the war used it as their local cafes. Well, now, I mean, the price of a cup of coffee is about half that of a king's ransom. And one sits there thinking, okay, so maybe in the old days you'd have saw Colette talking to Cocteau over there or so on, but they don't really mean all that much to me now. Now I prefer to go to an obscure or normal little cafe where one isn't paying through the nose for the benefit of sitting on a chair where maybe Hemingway sat, you know. The silly side of Paris, that. On the other hand, I love the Beaubourg. On my first visit, the Beaubourg or Pompidou Museum wasn't there. Les Halles still existed. It's a building which proves something, I think, very much about Paris, that it can absorb anything. In London, if you put up a new building, people scream and shout and hate it very much, like the Lloyd's building. But the Pompidou is immediately taken into the French heart, although it's very modern, although it's very high-tech. It somehow immediately forms a part of the thing. And in the square outside, with none of the self-consciousness of Covent Garden, there are jugglers and performers and improvisers and mime artists and people swallowing fire and so on, riding around on unicycles. And it does seem spontaneous. It doesn't seem arranged or quaint. The Parisians are in love with technology, which I find awful. I mean, I don't like technology anyway, but in Paris it seems to be a kind of blasphemy, but they wanted to prove that they are not an old has-been, an aging woman, you know, with heavy makeup on. The first indication of this was a film by Jean-Luc Godard called Alphaville, in which the characters were entirely surrounded by technology of all sorts and were losing their individuality, were becoming dead creatures and under threat. And as in so many things, Godard is always irritating at the time, but then later on you see that he was absolutely spot on, you know. Alphaville is what Paris could become because they want to be modern, you know. The awful invasion of English used wrongly all the time to describe events, you know, le discours, which was originally a French word, but has somehow become not French anymore, is depressing. I don't know. I think the time is depressing. I think everywhere is depressing. So one shouldn't be altogether surprised that one is constantly being fed electronic information on the metros and so on nowadays. But one is, perhaps, if one is of a certain age, saddened. And one does cling on to those signs, those indications that not is all yet lost. But I do, alas, think it's only a question of time. Luckily, the French are very conscious of their culture, so perhaps they will restrain themselves more than some places have when it comes to knocking down stuff. They won't knock down as much. On the other hand, they're cleaning it all up very much. I think this is not altogether a good sign. You know, one says, oh, look how marvellously clean the buildings are. But in a way, part of their charm was their patina. the fact that they were as dirty as they'd always been, and the gleaming sort of Hollywood version of Paris that one sees in certain areas now is depressing also. Can Paris revive culturally? Can it ever lead again? I don't think so, really, because the world in which it led is different. It was a world where, even with the invention of the aeroplane, it took some time to get anywhere. One travelled in a sort of dignified way across the channel in a boat, probably, and then on a train. One pulls into the centre of the town. Now one flies in to the De Gaulle Airport, which is like airports all over the world. And one drives in past great grey concrete blocks of flats and the outer suburbs, which have nothing to do with the old suburbs of Paris, I think. And it is attacked by universality of culture, you know, by television, by commercialized rock, by everything. It is under siege. And I don't think it has the spirit or the inspiration to reanimate itself as a culture somehow.
Un autre pays à présent, avec un village dedans, et il pense entrons, et il entre. Et vient une auberge, il y est entré, trois dessins, boira son verre, et après.
Nevertheless, one can never fall out of love with her totally. I mean, I think however long I live and however much Paris loses what makes it Paris, and one hopes it won't, one will always be in love with Paris as it was when one first visited it. I mean, it's like living with someone who have become boring and repetitive and wrinkled and tiresome and hysterical and all those sort of things, whatever. And yet one always remembers in looking at them what they had been. And one loves them for that, anyway.
La saison printanière est des plus brillantes. Paris, tout en fête.
Grand Tour Paris was presented by George Melly. The readings were taken from Paris Peasant by Louis Aragon, Nadia by André Breton, Eugène Fodor's On the Continent of 1936, and Paris and the Surrealists by George Melly. They were read by Olivier Pierre. Grand Tour Paris was produced at Pebble Mill by Chris Wines.